Good afternoon, everyone. This is Pastor Kenny Lee with today's daily devotional on behalf of Marvel and Lexa United Methodist Churches. I want to welcome you to this time that we share every day, Monday through Friday. It's a beautiful day outside. You'll look behind me and you'll see fall colors are everywhere. If you haven't been able to get out and spend some time in nature this week, I just want to encourage you to take a drive, take a hike, go on a walk with your kids, just look around. Fall is in the air. It's a beautiful time. And I believe that God blessed us with this so that we could enjoy it together. Before I read today's scripture passage, I want to invite you into a moment of prayer with me. Let us pray. Holy God, we give you thanks for this day that you've given us. We thank you for the beauty of the world, which you created with your own hands and called good. Lord, at the end of your creation, you looked around and called it all very good. And we, along with you, God, come alongside you in the co-creative nature, the stewardship role that you've called us into as human beings when you sent us into the garden to tend for the Garden of Eden. Today, we ask that you would open our minds and hearts through the power of your Spirit. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Today's passage of Scripture is somewhat interesting. This is, as Paul Harvey would say, the rest of the story. We have read a good bit of Old Testament Scripture over the course of the last several months. We've been through much of the Exodus. We've looked heavily, especially last week and some this week, into the book of Joshua. And now we begin the book of Judges, and this is Judges 2. And I'll begin reading with verse 6. When Joshua dismissed the people, the Israelites all went down to their own inheritances to take possession of the land. The people worshiped the Lord all the days of Joshua and all of the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great work that the Lord had done for Israel. Joshua, son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110 years. So they buried him within the bounds of his inheritance at Timnath-Heres, in the hill country of Ephraim, north of Mount Gaash. Moreover, the whole generation was gathered to their ancestors, and another generation grew up after them who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel. Then the Israelites did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and worshiped the Baals, and they abandoned the Lord, the God of their ancestors, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt. They followed other gods, and from among the gods of the peoples who were all around them, and bowed down to them, and they provoked the Lord to anger. They abandoned the Lord and worshiped Baal and Astartes. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he gave them over to plunderers who plundered them, and he sold them into the power of their enemies all around so that they could no longer withstand their enemies. Whenever they marched out, the hand of the Lord was against them to bring misfortune, as the Lord had warned them and sworn to them, and they were in great distress. Then the Lord raised up judges who delivered them out of the power of those who plundered them. Yet they would not even listen to their judges, for they lusted after the other gods and bowed down to them. They soon turned aside from the way in which their ancestors had walked, who had obeyed the commandments of the Lord and did not follow their example. This is the word of God for us today. Israel has been delivered from once being a slave people in Egypt, a people who entered into the Nile River Delta with only 70 persons and marched out with hundreds of thousands of people, all the same ethnicity, all the same descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And they have served God. The slave generation, because of their disobedience to God and God's commandment to go in to take possession of the land, they all pass away as Israel wanders the wilderness. And then as they prepare to enter into the promised land, recall that God stops the waters of a flooded Jordan and allows these people who have wandered the wilderness, who are descendants of the people who were slaves in Egypt, he allows them to cross over the Jordan on dry ground. And then God makes a covenant with his people, and God instructs the leaders of the Israelites to circumcise all of the males who'd not been circumcised during the course of the time that they wandered the wilderness. And so this mark of the covenant is placed on the very flesh of these people who are only just beginning to understand for themselves who God was and what God is about to do in their midst. And they go in and they begin to fight battles against these established kingdoms in the promised land. And they begin to take possession of the land that God has promised them as their inheritance. And these people begin to believe God and to know that God is at work in their midst. And they know that God is faithful. And because of that, they choose to be faithful to God as well. They choose to follow after the God of their ancestors. And God proves to them his will is to be accomplished in their lives. And so these people follow after the Lord. They're obedient. They have conquered their enemies. God has given them this land, and they enter into this time of rest. And it says that all the people that experienced God's work in their lives firsthand, these people who had grown up hearing the stories, these people whose arms had been strengthened, who were able to go and do that which God had called them to do, they listen to God, they obey God, and it goes well with them. But then there comes after them, after their warring is over, after they no longer need to fight any longer to take possession of this land, they begin to see that God has given them all of these good things, but they fail to live into one of the primary commands that God has given them, and that is to pass on faith in Yahweh to the next generation. I've said this to you before, that the church is only ever one generation away from extinction. It has been that way since the day of Jesus. Every successive generation has to appropriate faith for themselves, and every generation, it is incumbent on us as parents and grandparents, as leaders and elders in the church, to teach up the next generation of children, to make sure that they receive instruction in the ways of God. It's necessary for us as we do that to contextualize the scripture, to help them to relate to it, because scripture is always relatable, and sometimes the culture of 2,000 years before doesn't necessarily relate really well to the culture of today. And last night, as I was at youth meeting, Miss Emily Johnson used a couple of instances in the ministry of Jesus to help us to understand COVID-19 and maybe some of the ways that we feel pretty isolated right now. And she talked about how COVID-19 perhaps was like leprosy on some levels. Leprosy was one of those diseases that made you to be separate from the community. You were ostracized. You weren't allowed to be a part of the general population because you were considered to be unclean, and you were a source of contagion, contamination, and uncleanness for those around. And then she also mentioned the woman with the issue of blood, and it was the same set of circumstances. She was, because of her condition, a medical condition that she had no control over, she is ostracized, isolated, can't be in community, is a source of contamination and uncleanliness. And those kids, because of what they're going through, and because of the creative way that Miss Emily approached that passage of scripture, it was nothing short of amazing. I mean, I'm a preacher. I'm supposed to be able to think about these things, but I'm not necessarily always the best youth minister, perhaps because I'm somewhat of a kid myself. Anyway, All this to say that it's important for us as parents, as leaders, as teachers, as grandparents, as leaders in the community, to understand that if our world is going to get better, if God's kingdom is going to come on earth as in heaven, it's because we're going to pass on our faith. We're going to tell the stories of our faith. We're going to retell the stories of the Bible in light of today's world. We're going to remind these kids that God is still the God of the Bible, that the old covenant and the new covenant, the Old Testament and the New Testament, it's one cohesive communication of God toward us as His beloved people. I want to share a hymn. This is Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. I want you to understand that this is a more contemporary rendering of this hymn by Shane and Shane. I'll include the link to this video in the description when I post today's daily devotional. And you elder statesmen, you folks who are leaders in the church, I just want to remind you that it's also our duty to mentor and then pass on leadership roles to those who perhaps are younger than us, people with whom this music may resonate. And it's familiar to us, but it's also different. And I just invite you all, as you consider this, to let's enjoy this together and enjoy the beauty of the outdoors.
Oh,
a soaring piece of worship music. I hope that you enjoyed the views today, that you enjoyed the music, that God has spoken to you in something that we've read or shared. And I invite you to pray with me as we prepare to close. God, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for your love that's poured out on our hearts every day. God, remind us today to teach our children, to guide them in the ways that lead to life. Lord, as someone before us guided our way. Lord, help us to reach out beyond the walls, to touch lives in our community for your kingdom. As we continue to be faithful to your word, O God, to your work, we thank you for your work in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Hope that you guys have a great rest of your day. Remember to like, share, subscribe, and follow Jesus.